Danny Fikert said last week that Asians and Hispanics are the fastest growing racial minorities in the community. Hispanics will be far less economically well off. What is being done to prepare for these demographic changes? They would be the most logical person.
I mean, certainly Tulsa is becoming more multicultural with a broader range of ethnic groups, and when we talk about racial issues in Tulsa and Oklahoma, it isn't simply black and white any longer. And certainly the Hispanic immigration is an extremely consequential development for the state. In some ways, I think there's reason to be optimistic that Hispanic immigration is going to resemble other immigrations with initial difficulties and then over time moving up the economic ladder and enjoying opportunities. I think now, you know, being an early immigration, we're seeing difficulties that seem particularly challenging at this moment, but 20 years from now, 30 years from now may seem much less so. But it does, you know, there are certainly language issues, and it's been a strain at the in terms of schools, in terms of social services, in terms of various community institutions to provide enough people with the language and cultural skills to help integrate the Hispanic community. It's something that we just need to be attentive to and work on if we're going to make progress. I don't think that there's a single solution. It's just going to take time.
Thank you. Twan, would you share with us your picture of Tulsa's process to raise itself from a 2 to a 5, or at least a 4 in terms of race relations?
That's probably the easiest question I've had all night. I think it starts definitely with the political process, because it's taught to us that all politics starts as local. And I think when we allow ourselves to make our voices heard to the people that represent us, and really the people that I'm looking at in this room, when we allow make our voices heard, I think that begins to hold them accountable. But how we bring it up is we begin to, I know when Kathy Taylor was mayor, she started the Mayor and Police Community Coalition. And coincidentally, Hannibal Johnson happens to chair that committee. But when Bartlett took over, he didn't do away with it. He kept it there. Albeit he's not as active as former Mayor Taylor, but he didn't do away with it. And I think those are the type of leadership qualities we need to look for when we're asking for representation. Because again, many of us are busy here today. We have families, we have jobs, we have a lot of things that we have to take care of, but there's people who volunteer and want to go down and represent us. Taking the time out to make a phone call, send an email, is I think how you begin to raise it. Because if there's no challenge for a policy to be changed, if I have the authority not to change it, then I'm gonna do absolutely nothing, because there's no heat or pressure being put on me. So it has to begin with our leadership. I don't know any other way to where we can see it influence outside of those who sit there and make the decisions to either implement policy or hold staff accountable to ensure that they're abiding by that policy that is in place.
Thank you. Jocelyn, you're up, this is what I imagined. This is the one, speaking of imagining, this is gonna require some imagination, but I'm sure you're up to the task. What would Tulsa be like today if the 1921 Tulsa race riot had not happened, in terms of economic vitality, intellectual capital, and trust? And the part two of that is, how might we get there today?
I'm not sure. I think if I take that apart in pieces and deal with the one that really struck me most, I think trust within the community would be very different. I got to gossiping in the back, and we were talking about who was here and why there were not more people of color in the room. And I, of course, said, I don't know. I mean, I got the one person I'm in charge of here. and I have a helper. And I got him here, so I can account for two people, but that's not it. My very closest friend in the world is not here, and I'm not sure why.
Your former very
closest friend in the world. But I think that the trust issue is affected directly by the 1921 Tulsa race riot. I promise you, if I come by your neighborhood and light your house on fire, you will not trust me. We will not be potentially best friends ever again. And when you see someone that might be me the next time, you will say out loud in the car with your grandchildren, don't trust Sylvie. Don't trust her. And then when you realize it wasn't that one that lit your house on fire, don't trust any of them. That's how we act as humans. That's just how we roll. Without that event, we might have different trust in the community, but remember that that was a singularly bad event, but it was built on top of a foundation of unequal treatment, disregard, and uncaring people. So across the board, I mean, there were people who were really mad that the people in Greenwood had decided we can have our own stuff then. Just because you said we couldn't use play with your stuff, that doesn't mean we're not going to have stuff. There were people who were really mad about that, and that maybe that is believed to be part of what happened. So the trust issue might be different if there had been a 1921 Tulsa race riot. Economically, it would be different because there was in the Greenwood community a class of people who were doing extraordinarily well. There were Black people who were not. So the complexity of African American and all of the other non-white communities in town might be greater. But the truth is that those communities are very complex now. We just don't talk about that so much. So I really don't know how it would have been. It might have been better, it might have been even harder, but our motion now is to move one person at a time to change it.
Thank you. Question for David. Having grown up in Canada without a history of slavery, what do you find most difficult to understand about U.S. race relations?
You know, I think every country has certain foundational conflicts. Canada is French-English relations, which manifests itself in everything that happens in the country, somehow plays out within the prism of French-English history. Certainly in Quebec, which is my native province, it's a place where every time you open your mouth as a native English-speaking person, you're making a political statement. If you're speaking to a French person and you speak in English, you're making one statement. If you speak in French, you're making another statement. I spent time in France, and in France there's a fairly substantial Black African population, but it's not politically charged in the way that the North African community is based on their colonial. So in the United States, with the history of slavery, with the history of segregation, with the history of desegregation, civil rights movement, I think it took me time to realize how present that is in everything that happens here, how strong and overwhelming that history is. So it's not something I grew up with, but you know, I've sort of had to learn to appreciate that, and that particularly for African Americans, that the reality of race is a daily, hourly, constant reality that they have to, you know, continue to confront.
Thank you. Twan. We've talked about the demographic makeup of the room today. So the question is, what would it take to allow African Americans, Native Americans, etc., to feel more comfortable and be more interested in a dialogue such as this?
I think one of the main things is to embrace the fact that what you see on TV is not really reality.
Jocelyn, how does compassion factor into unifying a divided community?
The decision to act one person at a time has to come from both your head and your heart. And that's where the compassion comes in. We can make rules, and we can make guidelines, and we can encourage everybody to do whatever we think would work to make this room more diverse even for next week. But unless you take whatever those ideas are into your heart, you're not going to act on them. You'll carry them around, and I know the whole osmosis thing, I carry those for years. You'll carry the idea around, and it'll be a good idea. You write it down, carry it down. But if you don't take it to heart and act on it, it's really meaningless. So until we're able to feel more empathy, more connection, to believe, as Twan said, to know that what you see on TV is not reality, until we're able to do those things and compel ourselves to act out of our habits, we won't have any change. And the compassion that we need to push ourselves to act plays a huge role. And some of that just comes from thinking about it and realizing that we have to change ourselves, I believe.